And now, broadcasting live from the banks of the Niagara River, live from Sessions on the River, it's the Jim Fannin Show. Ready? We're rolling.
We're rolling. Thanks very much. It's the Jim Fannin Show. We've been here all day. We're doing bands on the hour, and we've got a tight show planned for you today. Thanks to Aaron Berger for tuning up there and getting all tight. Matthew James Blake is in the booth at the back. Thanks for the beautiful introduction, and we are live from Sessions on the River right here in Fort Erie, right on the banks down by the Peace Bridge. We've got, as I said, music on the hour every hour right till midnight tonight. So this is the first show in 2 years. It might be a little bit of rusty, so that's why I call in the bigwigs for political guests. So 2 years off. Since that time, I've run in a couple of elections, one municipally for mayor in St. Catharines. Not really to win, running as a perpetual Green Party candidate. And winning is never anything that I, invent as a possibility, unfortunately. It's about bringing better conversation to the issues and about calling these guys on their inauthenticities of the, the major political parties. Green is... a party that doesn't change their policy with the wind like these guys do. So for the last couple of years, I've been doing that and staying busy lately, not because of my hard work, but because of a hot real estate market. I'm a hero more than I've ever been, selling stuff for way more than we ever thought it was worth in record time. And again, that doesn't make me special. The market is pretty hot right now. So I've been spending some time doing some real estate, and I'm right in the middle of launching another business that I actually can't talk about yet. But so busy, busy boy. This has taken a couple months, 2.5 months, maybe, of hard work. Thanks to Chris Curry. He's the owner-operator here at Sessions on the River. We got a liquor license for 140 people. Hopefully we'll get close to that later. We got a good crew in the house now. So the idea was, do a show that focuses on the music and the issues, and my shitty political takes will come into it as well. So, and my guests' shitty political takes. We don't have a management here to answer to. We don't have our corporate overlords that say, you can't talk about Marineland. It's no hold barred. We're going to go and talk about whatever we like. One issue that's near and dear to my heart right now, although I'm not really actively participating in the it right now, is this PSW issue. Some have said we sold our soul to China and Niagara Falls with this huge development on Thundering Waters, a really important wetland and forest. And so our political guest tonight can speak to that kind of stuff, so we'll go hard at that. So first off, Gord Miller is my first guest. We'll get him up in a second. I'll just give you a quick rundown just because he thinks he's coming up. But not yet, Gord. So Gord Miller is a former Environmental Commissioner of Ontario, 2000 to 2015, I believe, 15 years, appointed by multiple different stripes of government. There's a guy that's walked the political line. He's got so much deep knowledge. He's been an expert witness and testifying, and some of these, we're just moved the PSW next door, five blocks over. You can't fucking move an ecosystem, man. It's just, so Gord will speak to that a little bit. So I'm really happy he's made a drive in. He's made a real effort, and everyone that's participated on the show, thank you very much, the artists and guests included. I'm honored to have you here. So Gord Miller is my first guest that we're going to bring up. Then the leader of the Green Party of Ontario, Mike Schreiner. I like to call these guys friends. We've actually had beers together, talked about things that you can't talk about on air. Well, we can talk about anything we want today, but as a leader of the Green Party, I can appreciate if he's got to walk that politically correct line sometimes. So we'll bring him up. Greg Vezina, on the other hand, is a guy that has walked many political lines, hung himself on a few of those lines, maybe. I don't know. Greg Vezina is the founder and chairman of a company called Hydro Fuel Inc. Did you know you can burn ammonia as a fuel, and we can make electric power from it? Its exhaust is water vapor, and you can make it in your backyard. So Greg hasn't had the easiest time getting that out of you. There's no money in hydro fuel, is there? I don't know. So it's not the 100-mile-an-hour or 100-mile carburetor or whatever. Greg Vezina, again, I call these guys friends of mine. I've known Greg. Greg talked me into running in the first election that I ever ran in 1993. Political Nothing. Newbie. I didn't know anything. Greg, I get the call from, again, a guy I'd lived with and spent a lot of time, was mentored by in the early 90s. And I get the call. And it's like, ring, ring. Yeah. Vez. Yeah, Jimmy. Yeah, we need you to run in Niagara South, or Niagara Center, it was called. I'm like, not on your fucking life. Are you crazy? Sorry. There's kids in the... Not on your life. So now I got an internet radio show. I can't say the bad words because I got kids in the audience. So I was green as green could be. I said, I'll do it, but I won't do, like, I'm not doing anything. That's okay. We'll put up the $1,000. He put the $1,000 up. You got to go get 100 signatures. You can be a paper candidate. You don't have to do a damn thing. And I said, okay, I'll do it. I considered it a favor at the time. Didn't really realize it was, wow, it was a favor the other way around. I really received something from that. So Pete Marina is probably still at the old station, the Giant that we call now, Seahow on Forks Road at the time, talked me in. He said, Jim, yeah, Green candidate, this is our last debate before the election. And somehow he got me to agree to go on this radio show. It was August 93, I think it was. Mulroney with a dissolving majority. That's enough, Fez. I get to the studio, August, silk shirt, long sleeve, soaked the chair with nerves. When I went for my voice, it actually, I didn't know that when you're that nervous, your vocal cords stretch so tight that when you went to speak, there was nothing there. I shit the bed. And it scared the life out of me. And then as the microphone came around, and I spent the night before at Vez's place, you know, talking into my Sony Walkman at the time, and listened to it in the cassette tape over and over, proportional representation, you know. Oh, my God. So anyways, Greg, thank you very much. He was my political influencer in 93, and I've run probably 10 elections since then under the Green banner. He is also, the leader of the None of the Above party. You ever know, you ever feel like you want to vote for none of these guys? Well, now there's a party that says, fuck all these guys. So Greg Vezina, leader of the None of the Above party. Also, oh, we got the hippies behind the set here. They're probably smoking weed or something. And author of Democracy A, Voter Guide to Action. So Jason Lupich is in the house with Erica Sherwood. They're cutting their second film right now. My scene as of The Sidewalk an hour ago is still in the flick. They're still writing it and shooting it and producing it like on the fly right now. A wicked, wicked talent in town. Jason Lupich, Erica Sherwood, thank you for being here. We'll talk about the movie Fight.
No.
Aaron Berger is all tuned up. I didn't have a band booked for the show, but it seems really fitting if you guys want to lead us in with a little ditty. Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars, we're waiting on John Alvers. He's in traffic. Was kind enough to pick up the van from Wellington Court. Thank you again. This show is brought to you by no one except Wellington Court. They're feeding you tonight. There's food around. Wow, it looks great. I can't wait to dive in. So Berger and picked us up a bass amp so that our boys that are using it, Theater Crisp, and Anthony Sweet wants the bass amp as well. John Alvers, this is Berger, Blake, and Gould the way they look right now. But when John Alvers gets here, they will be Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars, and they are just tight as hell. So guys, if you guys want to take it away and play a song, that'd be awesome. Aaron Berger, Berger, Blake, and Gould live on the Jim Fannin Show.
Thanks very much, Jim. This is the first for us. We were the rock and roll caterers today.
And amen.
Roll here in the Wellington Court catering van.
I'll sit over here. I'll be your sidekick.
Sounds good.
Head it. Head heavy.
Oh, wrong band. Sorry.
So we've been doing some recording recently with Joe Lipinski downtown in St. Catharines. And the next song we're going to play for you is called So Divine. And it's one of our new tracks that we've been working on in the studio.
I don't care if you're on time.
very much. Yeah, we have so much love for Jim Fan, and Jim is one of the biggest supporters of the Niagara music community here. He's somebody who shows up to shows, promotes all of the bands here, spends his money on buying CDs, and we're very grateful and honored to help him on his launch here, and may this be the first of many Jim Fannin shows here at Sessions on the River, Jim.
Thanks, Berger. Well done, man. You guys are sounding tight. I was wondering how long you were going to keep MJ in that booth already. It looks good with the earphones on and Matthew, James, Blake. Hey, you can keep talking. We can't hear a damn thing. See, whatever you want,
finally
MJ.
Finally found a way to shut him up.
Trey's show maybe be in the house later on. So, guys, thank you very much. So, really, are you going to let him out of there? Because that door needs to slide open if you are. I'm Jim Fannin. We're live from Sessions on the River. Thanks again to Chris Curry. He's the owner-operator here for mixing everything up. Thanks for the guests that have been on already and the guests that are to come. We're going. Our last band is at midnight. So this is, I've said this many times, just in case you're tuning in for the first time. This is all about the music and the love of the music and the love between these guys. And these guys' music has been hugely important in my life and just delved into it. And it's almost like a love affair I have with a lot of these albums, just like anyone else has done. But so I got a lot of time for these guys. The idea was to feature them and get them, because I'm tired of all their old music, get them back in studio and let's hear some new stuff. So that's what we're doing today. It's all about the issues and it's all about the music and the love. Speaking of love, Gord Miller is my next guest. He's a former environmental commissioner. Come on up, Gord. Right over here.
However you get there is fine.
Thank you, brother.
Hey.
Watch the cords.
No problem.
Gord Miller, again, thank you very much, first of all. This is this immense gratitude. You know, I'm fortunate enough. I'm sure not everyone has your cell phone number, and I'll tell the little story about how this came to be. I've been off the air for a couple of years and frustrated. You know, I'm a caller. I'm on a local radio station here and there, but you know, I used to have free will to do whatever I want, talk to anyone I want about whatever issue I want, and pretty much say whatever I want. It's a little bit more that way this time because I'm working for a proper station. But when I first, it's all about the music, right? So when I was kind of manic one day, and like I've really been itching to do something. It's been a year to the day on the 19th of the last federal election, which takes a lot out of me. People think I'm untouchable because I act that way, right? But I'm really a sensitive guy, and I found that running in these elections really leaves me scarred afterwards, you know? So I was itching to get back on. I guess I'm healed enough that I think I can do it. Although there's a Niagara West Glambrook of riding coming up, but actually we got a candidate for that. So it was about the music, but then my first call is to a guy like you because I'm so deeply concerned with some of our environmental issues. I know you've got some great knowledge and experience. So the call goes like this. He takes my call, first of all, and I catch him on the lake or on the river in your boat. Mm-hmm. And yeah, Jimmy, yeah. I just know him. I said, what are you doing for fun? Well, right now, I'm out on my boat on the river, and I'm not doing that anymore because I'm talking to you. So anyways, we talked 15 minutes or whatever, and I said, hey, here's what I'm doing, and I want you to come down. And he says, you know what? I'm driving in. I'm going back to the house now. I'll call you back when I get to my computer. And I got a voicemail message from him. He goes, well, I don't know if you said kid, but that's how I felt. You're like, you know, buddy, I don't know. I must have a small soft spot for you because I'm free, and yeah, I'll do it. I'll come down. So I really am grateful because I wouldn't
it's
have done
400
it.
400 kilometers. No, 500.
I wouldn't have done it if you hadn't have said yes. I wanted that premier guest, and we've got three or four of them today. So Gord Miller, thank you very much for coming in. Former Environmental Commissioner of Ontario, Green Party candidate for the feds under yep. Elizabeth May, which I actually, oh my God, did I do that again? Yeah, I did it with you. Well, you know, we thought maybe Guelph is a real, Mike Schreiner can talk a lot about Guelph. He's really laid some, you know, put the seeds down there. Mm-hmm. We, you know, optimistically thought that maybe you had a chance to get elected there. It didn't happen. Tell me a little bit about that experience. You had a pretty good job before you ran. So you get some time off. Did you feel a little beat up afterwards? Like, does it take a little bit out of it?
You know, being Environment Commissioner of Ontario is,
is a pretty high profile, you know, in the media, in your face job all the time, 24-hour job, really, you know. So moving to politics wasn't that hard, you know. I mean, and the intensity, in fact, I probably a little less in terms of the intensity of your life. But, of course, politics is a lot of door knocking and running around and physical stuff that was actually quite healthy for you. So, no, I had a pretty easy time of it. I mean,
no,
we're very, very hard. Wish the results were better than they were. We spent an awful lot of money. We spent more money on that campaign than any politician in the history of Canada. Did you know that? The number one expenditure for an election campaign in the last election, which is the richest thing, number one in Canada, you know, you have 338 ridings, four or five people running in every riding. The number one was my expenditure.
Can we fact check that quick?
And it's fact check.
It was on civil servant. You know,
it was in the National Post. My God!
Wow, so cool. Gord Miller is my guest, former Environmental Commissioner of Ontario, and just talking about his latest campaign as Green Party candidate. Do you stay connected to the party? Are you still involved in any?
Sure. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I mean, there's
yeah.
been a lot of talk, and you know, is Elizabeth? You know, does she want this? Is you know, I thought. When we first recruited, hey, I was at the party when we were recruiting Elizabeth. You remember those days. I ran for leadership with her, against her. Again, not to win. I got 29 votes. But, you know, her and David Cherenchenko were pretty tight. And there was a faction of the party, and I was pretty involved then. I was watching council and whatnot. There was a faction of the party that said, oh, we can't have this love affair. It would be nice to have the third-party guy in there to inject some of the issues, like horse trading. Like, well, we'll pull our candidate here for you, the NDP, if you do us a favor. You know, and that was a very contentious issue. So you stay connected to the party. And at that time, like, what's a better leader for the party than a star like Elizabeth May? She's good on her feet. She's witty. She's got deep, deep knowledge and experience. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we want that kind of star power, you know, and she's been great. She got herself elected. And, you know, that was the decision the council chose, put all the resources in one riding and get her elected. It worked, thank God, because if it hadn't, it would have been correct.
Didn't work for me.
Yeah. And that, and you got the that kind of treatment as well. So, yeah. You know, and I'm in the background going, dude, there's our next freaking leader right there, you know? And, you know, we talked about this off the air, and, it's, you know, you don't speak French or whatever, but do you see a leadership role in the party, whether it's leader or deputy or advisor, shadow?
Well, I'm still on the shadow cabinet.
Okay.
On the federal riding, and I'm a senior policy advisor to Mike Schreiner, the Ontario Party.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so there's some recruiting going
still,
on.
I'm still around.
You guys are stealing staff members, too, from the GPC here and
there. We're lurking in the back room. I'm a back room boy now, you know.
Okay.
Well. See, so that's so I'm not, I haven't, you know, parted from the party. I just stepped back from the light, you know.
Cool. Nobody really cares about the Green Party. So let's get into the issues. Tell us about.
I care about the Green Party.
Oh, okay.
And you do too.
Nobody that's listening to this show gives a shit. Says the none of the above party from the Peating Gallery.
Let's talk wetlands.
Yeah? Is that something that's a real.
Oh, it is.
Hot issue for you?
It is. And
so
we
haven't even gone down the trail yet, right? Because city council, it came to council. They got bombarded. They had too many people show up. And somebody in their wisdom said, we can't deal with this. We need a bigger venue. We need more consultation. So we're just at the beginning. Now the groups are formed.
I was just testifying at an Ontario Municipal Board hearing on a provincially significant wetland a couple of weeks ago. That hearing hasn't finished yet. But, you know, it's something very near and dear to my heart. You know, in Ontario, wetlands, I think people know intuitively how important wetlands are, ecologically on the landscape. And we've lost 80% of our wetlands in southern Ontario that were originally there, right? Mm. So what we did some years ago, and people have to understand, this thing is called a provincially significant wetland. What does that mean? Well, it means when we had a look at wetlands, we said some wetlands are really, really important. Other wetlands, not so much, and we can give up some. So we developed this 20 years ago. Now we developed a classification system, scientific-based classification system. We said we're going to look at the wetlands that are left in Ontario, southern Ontario especially, and we're going to say we'll classify them, you know, by a system. And you have to be a qualified person, a trained person to classify them. I used to be that kind of person, but I'm out of date now. And then we're going to find some. So some would be locally significant. They're pretty, you know, general. Could be changed, replaced, or moved perhaps. There could be things that are regionally significant. But we're going to identify those ones that are provincially significant. Those are very, very special. There are not very many left. There's not many in the province. A tiny area of the province where we say those have scored so high because of endangered species, because of their location uniqueness, because of not just ecological but also cultural values and the importance. And if they score that high, they're provincially significant. And then we're going to change the provincial policy statement, which is a part of the Planning Act, part of the legislation in a way. It says there should be no development in provincially significant wetlands. And the law says we must be consistent with the provincial policy statement. We must be consistent with that. There should be no development in provincially significant wetlands. It's a tiny restriction we put on things, but we recognize this area down here. Now you guys have got one. You've got a provincially significant wetland, and the law is clear. And I don't know where anybody gets off saying that you can develop or move or change a provincially significant wetland. You can't. That's by very definition. They're part of the tiny percentage in a landscape that ecologically has to be left alone and has to be allowed to function.
Thank you for that. Now, something struck a chord with me. You said, we know. These are important to our ecosystem, to our agricultural existence, to our culture in some cases. And I think we've been taught that, because I think back in the day, you're like, oh, fuck it, just fill it in.
Fill it in, yeah.
Well, that's how we lost. On your own land, and we didn't need permits, and that's the useless part of the land back there. So I think we've grown a little bit more sensitive to that kind of thing. Now, maybe the natives were more sensitive to that kind of thing.
Of course they
maybe
were, yeah.
Even the early settlers were probably not, but the wisdom and the elders of the natives, this kind of stuff is spiritually and culturally significant to them as well. So who fucking cares really if we pave one more over?
Yeah, right.
You know, like what difference is it going to make to Niagara Falls? Like they're going to say, well, no, this development goes as is. And you get this massive, massive infrastructure spending, private money,
mm-hmm.
or, if we can't do it, can't have it our way, we won't have it. So really, who cares? Like, well, why are we hanging on to these little pieces of useless, you know, maybe you could speak to the significance of them.
Well, sure. I mean, that's, you know, there's living things on the landscape of the land, right? And think of the land as like a fabric, and there's some spots in the fabric that are really, really critical. You know, you can't have it. Picture, well, you can see it. You can see, go down Toronto, and you know, how far do you have to go to see really living wildlife and living ecosystems that are functioning properly, right? It's just an urban landscape that goes on and on and on and on. So there have to be spots on the fabric of the landscape where life can continue, the ecosystem can function, and these wetlands are critical parts of that. And there's a whole bunch of roles they play in terms of, but I think most significantly, the most big general concept is there have to be spots on the landscape to make it all work. To allow the birds to migrate and to allow the species, the little creatures, little amphibians and frogs and the various kinds of creatures, somewhere they can go to breed, right?
So they
can live in a greater landscape, but there are special areas that they have to be, we have to save. They have to have some spots to go.
And we're not immediately aware of the impact of that loss and the chain domino effect that it might have down the way. Now, talk to me a little bit about the importance of saving something that's unique and one of the last things. Why is that important that it's last Carolinian forest? I mean, who cares? We're fucking paving them down anyways.
Well, you know,
look at down in the south. They do it everywhere. You know what I mean?
There's a famous author, a naturalist. Well, he started off as an exploiter of wildlife, and he developed a whole philosophy about nature and changed his thinking during his life, called Aldo Leopold. And he had a great line. You know, we used to... when I was young, I used to, and my dad used to do it too. You know, if something broke, you know, you took it apart and tried to fix it. We call it tinkering, right? You know, you take it all apart. Well, I can fix that. You know, I remember my poor mother had a toaster disassembled for about 3 years, right? Until she finally went out and bit the bullet and bought a new one, right? Nowadays, we don't tinker so much because we don't know how these things work.
Disposable society.
But Louis Leopold said, you know, the first rule of intelligent tinkering is to keep all the parts, okay? And that's when you were playing ecological games, when we're tearing apart ecosystems, you gotta keep all the parts. We might know why something's, we might not know why something's important till after we destroy it and it's gone. Great. And then I say, oh, we shouldn't have done that, right? And that's, so you can't answer in the negative. You can't say, well, why should we keep that? Well, because it's part of nature, it has some importance, some function, and if we lose it entirely, We'll find out the consequences then.
Gord Miller is my guest. He's the former Ontario's Environment Commissioner. I used to call him the Eco-Commish. Eco guy now on Twitter. It's GUI or something.
Yeah,
Eco.
Like in Gaia. So G-A-I. E-C-O-G-A-I.
He's my guest. Up next, we're going to have Mike Schreiner. And then Greg Vezina will form part of our green panel. But just on the way out, we're going to take a short break and then come back with a little bit more Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars now that John Alvers is here. So thanks for tuning in. I'm Jim Fannin. This is Gord Miller. We're live from Sessions on the River. Gord, tell us a little bit about the path that we're headed down with the people that are opposing this development. Well, not the development. They just don't want them to pave over this part of it.
Just put it somewhere else, right? I mean, there's other places
you
can go.
Well, you can do the development without taking that piece of land and build right up next to whatever it is, the guidelines. So tell us the path. What do we have to expect politically? Like, first we go to city council. What if they ratify it then? What if they go, okay, we're good.
We would wish that the council would do the...
respect the provincial guidelines? No. This is Niagara Falls, for crying out loud.
Okay, well, let's assume...
We already made the deal with the devil. I'm sure the money's changed hands.
If it goes bad...
The deposit has been taken.
And the council makes a decision to go ahead with this, then unfortunately, it's because it costs time and money for people, but there's got to be people who are opposed to put together an appeal to the Ontario Municipal Board. That's the mechanism we had.
Okay.
And then there's a hearing at the Ontario Municipal Board, and people come and give evidence on both sides. And
they're
board.
Completely on the take. The OMB's been bought by private interest groups. Really? Okay, so they're going to get a fair shake at the OMB.
They'll get a fair shake.
How many decisions have you been concerned about that the OMB's made that you wish didn't go the way they went?
Oh, well, there's quite a few of those.
Okay,
but there's been some big wins, too, some where there was millions of dollars involved, and their OMB, you know, went for the environmental side and stopped it.
So not knowing anything about this, what is it, a coin flip for whether or not this place gets protected?
I'd say, you know, because I spoke to Toronto, the law, well, of course, I've just been before the OMB, and there's no decision on that one yet, so I don't know how that works. But
right. But
the argument is, you know, the Planning Act says you must follow the provincial policy statement. The provincial policy statement says no development in provincially significant wetlands. So, you know, it's pretty clear. That's a pretty strong argument. And I don't know. I think you have to go make the argument, unfortunately, not toss time and money.
Gord Miller is my guest. Chris, we're going to take a break right now, and we'll come back with Mike Schreiner. We're going to talk to the leader of the Green Party of Ontario. If you could take us out, a little bit of music there. Chris Curry, are you in the booth? Oh, there he is. And then John is in the house, so we'll get a little sound check from him. We'll come back with Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars, morphed over from Berger, Blake, and Gould. And on cue, here they come. I'm the Jim Fannin Show. We'll be right back. Short break.
Just to calm my nervous heart. beer.
I'm just calling the host of Local Food. Bullseye's your guide to what's good in pop culture. Every week, I'll sit down with you, Zach Elvis Costello, Elizabeth Banks, and Spike Lee.
Right, yeah. He used to have me on. It was great, yeah.
So me playing that was where I met you.
Okay, gotcha. Did you play, because I was at the announcement for his candidacy in St. Catharines. You guys played there,
yes,
right? I thought we had met. Yeah, we met at that event. Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. You guys are going to play for a bit, right? I can get some more water. Like, I got a frog in my throat.
Sessions on the River. Thanks to everyone that showed up. We got more politics. Mike Schreiner's coming up next, and then we got Greg Besner. We're talking local green issues. This is Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars, and this song is called I Will Stand With You. Take it away, boys. From Niagara, working on a new album. That's I Will Stand With You. Thank you very much, boys. Awesome. This is the Jim Fannin Show. We're live from Sessions on the River. I'm not going to thank Chris Curry one more time. Yeah, you guys can unplug. I don't know. Click. Thanks to Wellington Court Restaurant. I just finally got the first bite of something. Guys, oh my God, did you taste that prosciutto pizza with whatever's on there? Oh my good Lord, it's nasty. So lots of free food. Get down here to Sessions on the River. Bands on the hour all day. We got our last acts at midnight. And if we still have any gas left in the tank at midnight and there's still anyone hanging around, we're going to do a jam and just let the cameras run. And so my thanks to many of the special guests. My next guest coming up is leader of the Green Party of Ontario, Mike Schreiner, a guy I've known for quite a long time who's made a difference without being elected, influencing policy by being the leader of a party that doesn't hold a seat in the House right now. So Mike Schreiner, come on up. Thanks for the time. I really appreciate it. Let's see it. I think, am I not standing while I shake your hand? Oh, I don't want to rip something down over here. Matthew.
Hey, it's great to be on today.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm
Before
really
we start, can I give
you.
This place a plug? I mean, yeah. This is amazing. Local beer, local wine, local food, local music. It can't get any better than this.
Well, I really appreciate you saying that. The first time I walked in here, said to Chris, you got a room for rent? Like, I don't want to leave. And if it gets ugly tonight, I might just be sleeping on the couch. Who knows? So we're going to have a big sleepover here. Mike Schreiner, leader of the Green Party of Ontario. Thanks again for taking the time.
My
really
pleasure.
Appreciate it. Well, we got so many things we can talk about. But my pet peeve right now is how we elect our politicians. And I know you sing from the same Tom book as I do. What's your experience of what's going on now with political reform? Maybe you can speak to it in the province. And I know you got an eye on the federal as well. So is this a fucking shell game again? Are we just going to play the part? I mean, McGuinty, we did vote on this once in Ontario. It wasn't, in my opinion, a very honest campaign. And Fez could speak to that when he comes
up.
You know, less information in something like this is just, you know, status quo. So speak to us about, if you think it's on the horizon, and what we can do to help move it along, if so.
Well, I think we have a great opportunity, but I tell you what, when the Prime Minister Trudeau backed off on electoral reform a couple days ago, the outrage across the country, I mean, he reversed himself in 24 hours. It was, I haven't seen a politician backtrack so quickly as he did on that one. And it is clear to me that a number of people voted Liberal in this election because of the promise in the first past the post voting system. If Trudeau backtracks on that and betrays those voters, he's going to pay the price in the next election.
Oh, you mean like the voters that he betrayed with the
with the LNG project?
How about the legalizing of marijuana?
Well, there's that one too. He's still dragging his feet on it.
Blair's shakedown in Toronto, they're taking these dispensaries down and targeting the high-profile ones that Jody and Mark Emery own.
Exactly.
And this is bullshit, man. They're going in, and you know what they're being charged with? Simple possession and zoning infractions. They're not even charging when distribution, which is what they're there for, really. I mean, that's so you can't speak out of both, you know. And he came to St. Catharines. He was in South Niagara yesterday. He's mobbed everywhere. Mm-hmm. He's a freaking rock star. I don't think he's the smartest guy around. He has learned to stick to the script. He's obviously got good political people around him. You don't get elected when you're not smart without that. But if he ever gets off script, he can barely, I'm going to trash Justin Trudeau, but he doesn't carry a conversation well, forget policy. So, I mean, we don't have recall mechanism, like none of the above party advocates for.
Yeah, we advocate for it too, and the Greens
and
too,
the Greens,
absolutely.
Exactly, yeah. And so we elect these guys time after time after time, and then we don't get kissed before we get bent, and then we complain our ass hurts. What are we doing here, man? It's the same old thing over and over.
Well, I think it's clear our democracy's broken, and it starts with our electoral system being broken. The answer to that is proportional representation, and if the Trudeau Liberals backtrack on that, they're going to pay a price politically. The other thing we have to do, which we're seeing both federally and provincially, is getting big money out of politics, which is an issue I've been leading the charge on here in Ontario. We absolutely need to ban corporate and union donations to political parties. We need to substantially lower the donation limits and the spending limits for political parties. And we need to bring in a public financing system that's available to every registered political party in the province.
You mean like we had federally?
Similar to what we had federally, though federally...
It doesn't exist anymore.
They don't anymore. Harper took it away.
Right.
And the thing is, if you want big money out of politics, it's much less expensive to have the public help fund political parties, not exclusively fund them. I think political parties should still go out and fundraise through grassroots donations. But we already have a public funding system in Ontario. It's a pay-to-play system. If you have deep pockets and you donate to a political party, the taxpayer gives you a tax refund, which benefits those wealthy donors that the Liberals, for example, have been selling cash for access events to. We want to get rid of that system, move to a vote-to-play system, and make sure it's available to all parties.
Mike Schreiner is my guest. He's the leader of the Green Party of Ontario. How long now, Mike?
Since 2009. Yeah, November 2009.
Okay, so tell me, give me your thoughts on this. Oh, jeez. 2006.
Yes.
August, AGM, Ottawa, Green Party of Canada, leadership race. That was the last one. That's 10 years ago, dude.
That's right.
Now, I know you don't have any responsibility there.
I don't.
But we used to... I think the Constitution was changed by the Board of Directors or whatever, however they changed the Constitution over there when they feel like changing it. But now we've got a system similar to the Green Party of Ontario. It's so frustrating for me. And Frank DeYoung was there a long time.
He was.
And yep. People really supported him 75% yes. of the time or more at the AGM.
Mm-hmm.
Leadership races build parties.
Yes.
You know, Frank maybe wasn't, he was maybe... walked out the door a little bit. His time was, you were up and coming. You had some organization behind you. You knew the rules. Get yourself elected. It was healthy for the party. Now, we haven't done it at the GPC level in 10 years. We haven't done it since. So talk to me about this lack of new membership, of new, I don't even care if it's just a debate about the issues. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe it doesn't have to be a formal leadership race, but this is what builds parties.
Mm-hmm.
This is where you get the infusion of new members. Vote for me. Vote. Well, 29 people voted for me in the last leadership race. But an important function of a so-called democratic grassroots party, which we don't always act as. Here you are, the benefit of it as the leader. Hey, you just go show up to the AGM. What's the threshold? 75?
75, yes.
Approval rating. So that's
right.
You're flying past that, and so is Elizabeth May. So we won't have another election for leader until you're good and damn ready that we will, right? So
well,
how's that grassroots or democratic?
Well, my hope is that any time, and I've made this very clear, any time that the members of the Green Party of Ontario are ready to get rid of me, I will walk away, like no doubt about it. And I'm not going to stay here forever. Like I've already said to folks, and a few people don't like it when I say this, but I intend to get elected in 2018. 20% in the last election. I think that laid the foundation to be elected in 2018. But if I don't get elected, I'm going to step down, and my time will be done, and we'll be ready for another leader to step forward.
I don't got my designs on your job. I mean,
no, you should start laying the. I'm going to get elected in 2018, so don't lay the groundwork too soon.
No.
But I really I'm trying to mentor other leaders in the party.
Awesome.
And through our shadow cabinet, through our deputy leaders, to ensure that we have a large number of candidates ready to step forward when the day comes for me to move on to something else.
Cool. Well, I really, really appreciate your frankness, and sorry if you thought you were ambushing there. I didn't.
I'm already on the record.
I haven't scripted a damn thing today. So
some people don't like it when I say that, though. They're like, Mike, don't say that. And it's like, I got to be honest with you.
I can see how the grassroots wants to hear that you're in it for the long haul, and that speaks to just the frankness and honesty of the conversation. So I really appreciate that. Mike Schreiner is my guest. He's the leader of the Green Party of Ontario. We're talking local green issues. Federal and provincial. What else is on your radar? And I want to give you props, number one, because there's no one elected from the Green Party of Ontario in Ontario, and you've got some, you got your talents in at Queen's Park.
Absolutely. You know what it's
in
been?
You're helping formulate policy. You're working with people from different parties, sponsoring bills. Like, man, this is so cool to see you having influence from the outside. We expect Elizabeth May to have influence. She's in there. Mm-hmm. She's part of the cog. You're not. So how are you getting it done?
Yeah, so this is all about grassroots organizing. And I think what we've proven is that if you have your facts straight and you go out and you engage the public and you get people to sign petitions and write letters and put pressure on the government, and you need a government, and you know, as critical as I am of the Liberal government here in Ontario, the one thing they do, they listen. And so when we've put pressure on them for things like fundraising reform legislation, or putting a price on carbon pollution, or saving the experimental lakes area, and we've gone with a compelling argument and a number of signatures on a petition, they've acted. The thing we're working on right now is protecting our water. So we have a whole Stop Giving Our Water campaign, and they're taking a step in the right direction on that one as well. And so when I met with the Minister of the Environment on it, I said, you know, I'm going to keep throwing postcards at you. I'm going to keep throwing letters at you until you guys fix the broken water-taking rules. And I've been told that those types of grassroots efforts that the Green Party is engaged in is making a difference and will continue to make a difference. And obviously, if we had a seat in the legislature, we'd be able to make an even bigger difference. But we're not going to let that hold us back, because some of the challenges the province is facing right now, they can't wait till 2018. We need some solutions right now.
Mike Schreiner is my guest. He's a longtime serving leader of the Green Party of Ontario since 2009. I'm Jim Fannin. We're broadcasting live from Sessions on the River. Get your ass down here. We got a liquor license. We got more live bands coming up at 6 o'clock. We're going to take a short break in a minute, but just a little bit more with Mike Schreiner. And then we're going to bring up Greg Vezina, who's a whole character unto himself, too.
Yes.
I can't wait to get Greg up here. And then we'll bring you all up together. We'll try and
make
it sound
like... Well, you know what I always say about Greg?
The view for boys, for political men. The view... like that, yeah. No, we're not going to do that. And if there's a bounty out for the first one that drops, I know, right? On the show after this, that costs you $50. Yeah. Mike Schreiner is my guest. I am Jim Fannin, live from Sessions on the River. Mike, I acknowledge you. I really think it's so cool that you're having that political influence at Queen's Park. We talked about the provincially, the PSWs, the wetlands here. I talked to Gord Miller, who's got such great deep knowledge, isn't he?
Just, oh, he's fantastic. He's a policy advisor for the Green Party of Ontario now.
Yeah.
And it's just, we're so fortunate to have somebody with his depth of knowledge.
And you talk about grassroots, like I'm kind of sit on the fence on, a lot of times I look at my grassroots activity and go, mm-hmm. like I run elections. It's, you know, what I do, I can contribute once in a while. And I'm so glad to hear you've got somebody in Niagara West Glanbrook, and we talk about that in a minute.
Yes.
Rick Dykstra rumored to be moving over, the old sitting federal MP for St. Catharines, moving over to a riding he doesn't live in, was born in. Will probably win that seat. And my opinion of Rick Dykstra is, one, he's surrounded himself with brilliant minds. I'm not saying that he doesn't have one. Rick is an intelligent guy. He played the political game pretty well there in the federal conservatives. You know, I think he was well coached. I think he's very reasonable. Yeah, he had a slip up in the last election with something that cost him some bad pub, but that's not why he lost the election, because of the Mansion House fiasco. The red tide was coming.
Absolutely.
And I think he's got designs on Premier. And I think he's got the political smarts and the backers to get there. And, you know, if we had a conservative Premier in Ontario, it wouldn't be the first time. And so... this is the first step for him, I think. And I'm like, you know, similar to when I didn't like the candidates that were running for mayor, I'm like, I can't let this happen, man. I just have to be part of the conversation. So I'm so glad you shut me down on that today, because I'm thinking, no, I've been praying for the health of our politicians. Please, no by-election, please. Many times I find myself victim of, like, you're the only guy, dude. Mm-hmm. Or you're, you know, I don't want to run a paper candidate.
Right.
So, and that's why I kind of come out of the retirement and... So that's what I think is going on over there. What have you got planned for that election, and how can we make a difference at that grassroots level, which is the most amazing experience that anyone can do, is vote for themselves, to put themselves on the ballot and go take the bullet and do what you think is right, whether it's the none of the above party or the Green Party. So
yeah, so we're excited. Donna Cridland, who is our shadow cabinet critic for food and agriculture or rural affairs, from Welland, ran in Welland last time, forced me running in this by-election. And one of the reasons I'm excited about having Donna run in this by-election is that she's a very strong advocate for protecting farmland, local food sources, and water. And so one of the challenges I've made to the other political leaders in Ontario is, why don't you take the food and water first pledge? It's simple. Protect prime farmland in this province from development and protect source water regions. If we can't eat and we can't drink, where are we? To date, I'm the only political leader in Ontario to sign the Food and Water First Pledge. Maybe Vezina has. I'll have to check on that. But at least out of those other three with seats at Queen's Park, none of them have said, I will sign the pledge to protect prime farmland and source water regions in this province.
Seems like
and
a
I think
no-brainer.
It's total no-brainer. And I think it's particularly appalling for conservatives who represent Rural ridings did not protect farmland. We're losing 350 acres of farmland a day in this province. That's the equivalent of the size of the city of Toronto on an annual basis. Hmm. And it's not just an environmental argument. It's not just a food security argument. It's an economic argument.
Well, that's what
the farming sector, 740,000 jobs in this province, over $40 billion contribution to our GDP, and we are destroying the asset base of that essential part of our provincial economy. I don't understand why they won't sign the Food and Water First Pledge.
So that's a really good point, and I think that's one that maybe we have not been good at communicating. And I say we as the Green Party, and we're not perfect, you know, not the most well-funded organization. We've got a lot of volunteers, and, you know, I talked to the girls at the office, and yeah, they're working hard over there, you know what I mean? So it falls on guys like us maybe to get it right sometimes, but I mean... anyways, I'm rambling now.
Yeah, well, Don will do a great job, and yeah. I think what we lack in financial resources, we make up for in passion and in volunteer mobilization and grassroots engagement. And I know Don is passionate about protecting farmland and water resources, and we're planning on making it a big issue in the by-election.
Mike Schreiner is my guest. We're going to take a short break. We're going to bring up Greg Vezina, who is founder and chairman of Hydrofuel Inc. He is the founder and leader of the None of the Above Party and an author of a book called Democracy, a Voter Guided to Action. Mike, thanks very much. We'll bring
thanks
you up
lot,
on
Jim.
As part
my
of
pleasure.
The panel. We're going to take a short break, and we're going to recue these Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars to bring us back with another song. And then 6 o'clock when we're done this show, I got some time to fill. Lupus, Sherwood are coming up. We're going to talk about the fight movie, the fight film. But next, Greg Vezina, who will be back right after this break.
Thank you, Niagara. We love you.
So Lee and I were talking earlier about the healing power of music, and it's definitely something that I've been able to bear witness to and experience. So I'm going to dedicate this song to you, Leah, and to Josh Mills, a good friend and someone who's a really big-hearted person. And it's really hard to be alive. So music is a huge blessing, and it's a way that we're able to, as artists, to process some of the difficult emotions that we carry. So this song was written by a good friend of ours, Carl David Onofrio, CD. And it's about the city of Niagara Falls, and I think it's a good example of beauty making as an antidote to depression.
For my depression.
Brothers Matthew James Blake and Nathaniel Gould, and going to invite Nathaniel up to lead us for a song here.
It's already a number one hit. That was quick.
Thank you.
You won't call me, you're in the rain. You won't call me, you're in the night. I keep asking you to stay. Stay here all the time. Won't you stay here for a while? Well, you can come in through my window. There's a ladder leading to my bed. I keep asking you to stay. Stay here all the time. Stay here for a while. Oh, well, I try so hard to forget you. You won't go away when my mind tells me a different story. Keep asking you to stay. You won't call me, you're in the rain. And you won't call me, you're in the night. I keep asking you to stay. Stay here all the time. Won't you stay here for a while?
Nicely done, guys. Come on, take a seat over here. We'll talk to you before we bring up Vez. I'm Jim Fannin. We're live from Sessions on the River in Fort Erie. Get your ass down here. We got cold beer, local wine, free food from Wallington Court. Thank you very much, Dale and Eric Peacock, for sponsoring the food today. They set us up. Is that good food or what? Wow. Thank you, Wallington Court. Lupus is in the house. Sherwood, thank you for your patience. We're going to talk a little bit bullshit politics after this, but Berger, Blanket, Gould, I just had a conversation with John out there. I'm glad he's healthy and okay. I know what it's like when you're an hour and a half late for a gig and you're stuck, the gardener's closed.
We're always an hour and a half late for a gig.
Oh, well, see, not everyone knows that, man. But so really cool, you guys. I know you're headed to a retreat. I know you're right in the middle of mixing post-production. Well, you're kind of like Lupish, I think. You're still writing, producing, and recording. Some's in the can, some's not. So I really appreciate your time today. You bucked up. picked up the van, which helped you guys out a little bit, and delivered the food to us. So, Nathaniel Gould, thank you very much. Black Flies, man, so many projects. Aaron Berger, again, Matthew James Blake. Wow. So Keegan was here. He was busting my balls earlier about how Aaron Berger is my boy. When's your boyfriend? When you want to talk about, is that all you want to talk about is Aaron Berger? And I'm like, what? Come on. But Berger would say I'm all about botting, you know, because I crush on botting. He's a witch on guitar. He writes
and
really
I don't know why you're into that guy anyway.
Book for Wanderers, man. The guy's a fucking witch. I love that kid. He's got swagger, blah, blah, blah. So I got to, hey, set up the show one more time here. I thank Gord Miller. He was one of the first people I called. Mike Schreiner is here. Greg Vezin's coming up next, formed part of a green panel. I wouldn't have done it if I hadn't got the support, and you guys are part of that. You guys are one of my first calls. I know I kind of steamrolled with the date. And you got Culture Jam going on in Niagara Falls all weekend, man. United Church on Lundy's Lane. Go check it out. They're banging there right now, right? Culture Jam.
We're making history in Niagara Falls.
Yeah, Perpetual
the
Peace
The longest,
project,
lowest maybe. Budget art festival you've ever been to.
Yeah, and we could tie. Hey, Niagara Falls funnest, gave some money out this year for the arts.
That's true. This is a good... It's a start. There's a lot more that needs to be done, but it is something. So the ball's moving in the right direction.
St. Catharines has been fortunate enough to have huge infrastructure spending, whether you think of the Meridian Center or something like that, where the Ice Dogs play, and we can bring some concerts in, or the First Center. Ontario Performing Arts Center. And there's been a number of different rooms there. We have Mark LaLama on today talking about how deeply important that infrastructure spending's been for the downtown core. The recipients are businesses like Mate Cafe, where Justin Trudeau shows up with 600 people yesterday, and I am not a Trudeau fan, as we've been discussing, but so cool to see the local. There's not, I mean, I was still in real estate, but 10 years ago I was downtown, and it was 50% vacancy rate in the commercial stuff. Closed, for sale, going out of business. Mm-hmm. Couldn't give the stuff away. Now try and find a vacant piece on St. Paul Street. Niagara Falls isn't there yet. They've made some good steps. You guys have been the recipient, so that kind of stuff. So talk to us a little bit about how important that funding's been to you to do these events. So the Culture Jam's a big commitment. Tell us a little bit about that and how important the funding's been.
Sure. So what's happening now, it's a week long. It's called a Culture Jam, and there's been a mix of music happening. There's artists that are there doing visual art. There's a dance event, a couple different dance events. One of them is an ecstatic dance. So this is a combination of improvised music with dance and movement. And then Sarah Murphy Dyson, who I think is part of the show today.
Yeah, she's doing her naked ballet.
So she has a dance workshop on that Sunday, a movement workshop that's happening between 2 and 4 p.m. And our friend Deb from Boston Pizza in Welland, Deb Zahara, she's going to be coming in to do yoga with music at 10 a.m. on Sunday. So, and the event was made possible by a grant. We got $2,500 to put something together. So it was a very modest amount of money. But C.D. Onofro, who played earlier, he helped to captain and put a lot of energy into making this event happen, and then got support from other friends and group members. And, without the funding for the arts is essential. You know, we need spaces to be able to create, and it's a struggle for everyone in different ways to be able to have enough money to live and to try and make art. And it's not something that's unique to us as artists, in that there's many people that are not in the arts and are very much struggling to have enough money and resources to live. But within the arts, if you don't have funding and support for what you're doing, it's a really tough go. So to see the way that the investment in cultural infrastructure in St. Catharines has brought life to the city. I mean, there's the talk of the creative city, and sometimes that it's when it's bullshit,
The compassionate city.
Yeah, well, the creative city is like another, like a bigger thing. Mm-hmm. Like the compassionate city is that Sensic's thing. Right. But the creative city is like a model that's been used by Richard Florida and other people.
All right.
But anyways, like you feel it, right? You feel that sense of vibrancy. And like you're saying, there are businesses that are doing well, and Mate's been a huge hub for a lot of
Struggled for many years on that corner before. They've been able to reap the rewards of that. Well,
Chris was somebody who had a vision for what he was doing and really saw a need, and he was looking 5 years in advance when he started renovating that space. And a lot of us have met there, and that's a gathering space for all kinds of folks in the community. But that's me rocking the mic a little bit there.
Yeah, no. And Aaron Berger, thank you very much. Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars, yes, will perform as Berger, Blake, and Gould, which you just did as acoustic. I love the setup, especially when MJ gets up there and blasts out Heaven. Oh, my God. Can we get a little Heaven before you go? Man, such big fans of you guys. But tell us, and this is why I love getting you here, man, because I've been through Color and Light. I've played the Black Flies over your stuff as well. You get to the point where I want something new. I want something fresh. It's still a great introduction for my friends, right? I've got, recorded on my iPhone from the market, Heaven. It's so beautiful. I get goosebumps just talking about it. I got goosebumps when I was there. Sit in my own St. Catharines downtown market and have you guys up there just belting out. And you're like, I don't even know what this, I know it's, but I don't know what I mean. And, I've said to you privately, what are you doing, man? You got a format down that you're fucking ripping off from someone, I know. And you're, because it's just so simple, but it's so soulful and deeply, it seems deeply personal and emotional to me when I'm listening to it. So talk to us a little bit about your...
Just taking my place in the tower of song, as Leonard Cohen would put it, right?
Yeah.
So I don't personally believe in copyright per se. So basically everything's already been done in a way. So it's just rearrangement is all it really is. We're just students, so...
Cool.
Keeping the torch burning.
Yeah, get down on that mic, Nate. You know how to use it.
I do.
So the new stuff. So Color and Light, one of my favorite albums. Played it to death. Oh, I'm so excited about the new stuff, and the new stuff is familiar to me because I've seen it live lots of times. So tell me where you guys are at and what you got coming up this weekend. I think it's really cool. Do you want to share about, your creative process here, where you're at?
This is always an Aaron project, but he always gets me involved with what he's doing. We seem to work well together.
Okay.
So he always comes and shows me what he's working on, and we kind of talk it out and trim the fat and add some bells and whistles and that. So it's been quite a while since Aaron's put out an album, and basically we're excited to be doing it finally, and we're able to do it, and we're halfway in the middle of doing it, and it's going well. But this weekend we're all just workshopping on Lake Erie. Gonna have some fun and get some harmonies down for the new stuff.
Right.
You're thinking of doing a probably around 8-song album.
That's right. And one big thing is that we're making a record. We're gonna be printing this on a vinyl, and we've never done that before. So with Joe Lipinski, so we're really excited about
Joe Lipinski, shout out to Joe.
And as far as the one of the things that we're also really looking forward to is different collaborations with this project. One of the ones that we've discussed is with Jason Lupish and Erica Sherwood making a video together.
They've done that one or two times.
So I mean they're so talented, and they make great videos and films, and we're excited to collaborate with them. And have another friend, Ian McKenzie, who is a filmmaker that's based in British Columbia. And we have a film that looks like it's going to be placed in a film that he's making called Children of Nowhere, about the Orphan Wisdom School that I'm a scholar of in the Ottawa Valley. And who knows where things are going to go. But it's a lot of different moving pieces, being able to record an album and having a sense of how to promote it and then market it and then tour it. So we really learned by falling completely on our faces. After we released Color and Light, we had no plan and basically spent all of our money, put it out, and it didn't get out of the Niagara region because we didn't have a plan. So we're trying to address some of those things that we didn't address last time. And also, it's so humbling to make music and be in the arts. You have your visions when you're a younger person of how your career is going to go, and this idea of stardom, whatever the hell that is, and things go to shit a bunch of times, and you end up, you see a lot of people who don't stay in the arts too.
Spit out.
Yeah, totally. It's a tough thing to have enough money to live, and it can be really discouraging, and hence the need for platforms like this show here, and we're very blessed in that the scene here, the art scene, is small, relatively small in Niagara, but people are very supportive amongst each other here, which helps a lot.
Amen to that. Aaron Berger is our guest with Nathaniel Gould and Matthew James Blake. I really appreciate your time. You got GoFundMe happening for this? What's...
Yeah, we haven't put it out yet, but yeah, okay. In the next several weeks, we're going to be looking for support for the record that we're making with Joe Lipinski, and that'll be all over social media and right. Such.
Thank you very much, Berger, Blake, and Gould, man. Matthew James, MJ, Berger, Nate.
Thanks,
I'll come around and hug you in a second. Okay, we're going to bring up Greg Vezina next. That's Berger, Blake, and Gould. Nathaniel Gould, Aaron Berger, Matthew James, Blake. I am Jim Fannin. One quick break. Chris, quick break, and then we'll come back in 1 second and just say goodbye to these guys, Matthew James, break. Blake. All right, I'm Jim Fannin. We're live from Sessions on the River. Back in a second after this break.
PACE improves the quality of after-school programs for kids and teens living in poverty. By ensuring that the caring adults in kids' lives are capable of providing high-quality after-school programming, PACE promotes positive outcomes for over 500,000 kids and teens each year. After-school programs transform young people's lives. PACE transforms after-school. Be an after-school ally. Learn, support, and join PACE in this vital work. Google PACE. That's PASE to learn more.
Curry, Chris, Curry. Thanks for doing this. Thanks for your patience, guys, for coming out. We're creating something from scratch here. Thanks to the people online. I haven't been real good about getting back to you, but thank you to everyone that's come out today. But it's built upon the music and the guests and the issues, and we got a little bit of personality that goes along with it. Hopefully you're enjoying it. This is the Jim Fannin Show. I'm working my lips for the first time today. Thanks for coming out, everyone. We're live from Sessions on the River. We're in Fort Erie, Wellington Court, man. They are laying some vicious, vicious food on us. Thanks to Dale and Eric Peacock from Wellington Court Restaurant. What a talent. Very well done. So thank you very much. Come on down here. We got a liquor license. You can watch your favorite bands. We got great bands coming up tonight. I've got a list of them here. But before that, let's get this talk show done. We're going till 6 live with this. I'm going to bring up Greg Vezina in a minute. I'll give you more on him. And then Lupish and Sherwood and cast and crew of the film Fight are coming up. And I can't wait to get these guys up. Sarah Murphy Dyson is in the house later. She does a naked ballerina that will absolutely destroy your heart. It'll rip it open and stomp on it on the ground, and then somehow you get put back together. One of the most beautiful performances I've ever seen. Changed my life. Seen it twice. Excited to bring her in tonight to do that for you guys. Anthony Sweet and, wow, Theater Crisp at 11 o'clock. So blessed, so grateful to have the support. Nate Gould, BBG, just got done here. Aaron Berger and the Blue Stars are off to a retreat, a session to tighten up this album a little bit, and they're going to come with a public funding campaign after that. Just one of just beautiful talent all the way around today. So thank you. I'm completely blessed and humbled. Yeah. Before we get too mushy, we continue. So we're going live till 6, and then we've got a full slate of bands on the hour after that. I am Jim Finn. And next up, an old friend of mine. We talked earlier, if you didn't get the message. In 1993, he called me and said, Jimmy, I need a favor. I said, Vez, anything? What? You got to run green in Niagara Center. I said, fuck you. No, seriously, what is the favor? We need a candidate. Mulroney, if we don't have 50 candidates run nationally, the party's dissolved. And all our finances are absorbed by the state. Not that we had any money at that time, but it was really important to Vez in that election that Mulroney tried to... Well, they said, if you don't run 50 candidates, you're not a party anymore. That's bullshit. So we ran the 53 or some odd candidates. Greg was, you know, a founder of that movement and very involved, I think, finance part of it as well. I was so new in the game at 24 years old. Not a political bone in my body that I didn't think I had. Turned into a complete monster and run many elections since. So in 93, I said yes to Vez, and the rest is his history. So Greg Vezina is the chairman of a company called Hydro Fuel Inc. His daughter's here today. Zoe, thanks for coming out. You didn't know that you could burn ammonia for to get electric power, right? Did you? You didn't know we could convert our complete fleet of transit and buses and trucks and ships and everything to ammonia, which we have already infrastructure partially built for. We don't need to rebuild it. So we're going down the wrong path. So he's the founder and chairman of Hydro Fuel Inc. He also wrote a book way back in the day called, with John Deverell, reporter for the Toronto Star, political guy as well, called Democracy A? Question mark. Typical. It was a voter guide to action. I talked about a lot of these democratic issues that we face still today, 25, 30 years later. Greg Vezina is also the leader of the None of the Above party, which we will not talk about tonight. I'm not spending any time on that. Greg Vezina, come on up here. Let's talk some politics, man.
Hey, thanks for having me, fan man.
Well, I wouldn't have done this if it wasn't for guys like you and Gord Miller. I think maybe you pull up on this one, yeah. The first call was to guys like you, Gord. I don't know who was. We've talked about this. I know Gord, and you're a busy guy too. But I got more access to you, and I love when you tell me, okay, Fannin, I'm fucking $250 an hour. Make it quick.
That's right.
And I know your rates have gone up since then. But Greg, I'm really so. This show doesn't happen without you guys saying yes to it. So I'm just coming on doing the easy part, but.
Well, it's nice to have you back. I miss the old days of rock and roll carol on the radio with Jim Fannin, the Jim Fannin show. Yeah. So now the Jim Fannin show's back out there, everybody in TV land. So here we go.
Yeah, we'll see. I'm committed to another show, Stereo Sunrise. It's going to come in, I think it's November 19th. I should probably get that date correct to promote it. But and if I get my ass out there and we can raise some sponsorship. If there's an interest in it, then it'll carry itself. I can't do this stuff free, right? So you understand that. So, all right. So Greg Vezina. So shit, what do you want to talk about? Let's start.
Well, first I want to do real quick shout out to Mike earlier because he did point out that yes, I signed a farm water deal. But I wanted to point out something that's very important that most Ontarians and Canadians don't realize, and that we've just found out by our experience with Nestle having priority over water, over municipalities and towns. When our environment minister, our premier, has a moratorium for 2 years on water permits, but our environment minister admitted, I know he heard this from Mike, that the free trade agreements prevent us from protecting our water. Wow. And people don't know that. And Maude Barlow and the Council of Canadians have been screaming about this, and Mel Hertig, the late Mel Hertig before he died, have been screaming about this for 30 years.
So they have recourse?
They will take our water, Jim. Okay? They own our water. We don't own our water. The president of Nestle was quoted in the press as saying, no human being has a right to water. They have a right to buy it from us. Okay? So the greatest gift that conservatives say that Brian Mulroney gave us was actually terminal. He gave away our water. And people don't know that he gave away our water. And it's gone.
And he's hailed and if the we greenest sign, prime ministers.
The greenest prime minister of Canada, if you're talking about stuffing your pockets full of paper bags full of green. So I just wanted to shout out to Mike because he's absolutely correct. And if we go ahead and they manage to close, thank God for the Wallagonians that have killed CETA. If they put CETA through and then we put TPP through, we won't own anything in our country. Nothing. We won't have the right to the resources. We won't have the right to manufacture with the resources. We will have the right to give everything we own to investors from transglobal corporations.
Now, back up a little bit because, you know, that's important.
And I didn't start with something heavy.
TPP.
Yeah.
We're at a precipice now, right now with a...
Well, our Prime Minister says that he's going to sign TPP. We'll see. We'll see. As far as the ECB, the European deal, which it appears may have fallen apart, well, you know, this morning now there's a new emergency meeting on, maybe it's not going to fall apart. The bottom line is that corporations aren't people. And as long as our courts and our laws treat them as people and give them rights over life, liberty, and security of the person, if economic security is meaningless to a citizen, but it's everything to a corporation. So we have a constitution and charter that gives us all these meaningless rights if we sign trade deals that take away our rights to go to our own courts and enforce them. And that's what these, you know, transnational tribunals do. So I didn't want to start off really heavy. I want to start off something.
Fuck, like, now we all want to go hang ourselves. You know, so, take down the shower rods, man.
Oh, man. Yeah, we're just getting there, guys. So, but so anyway, so, you know, now there's good news in the world, too. It's not all gloom and doom, okay? You know, I've been fighting for democracy since I was 13 years old, and the mayor in my hometown taught me about democracy. I'll tell everybody how I started in politics. You'll love this story. My hometown was North Bay, and it had the distinction of having a mayor named Merle Dickerson. Merle Dickerson is the only mayor ever elected and removed from office four times. The first time mayor was removed, from office was when he was charged with arson for burning down his hotel on Main Street for the insurance money. In the next election, Merle ran and won again. A few years later, Merle was busted. Found in a common gaming house. He had a gambling room in the back of a Chinese restaurant on Trout Lake Road. After Merle serves his 30 days, he's removed from office. Comes back the next election, runs and wins. A few years later, Merle took a 15-year-old to vote to seven different voting stations, declaring she was seven different people. Merle got busted for corrupt electoral practices, prevented from running from office for 4 years, waited 4 years, run, and won. And
this
then
is
died.
Not
in,
true.
And it's a true story, ask Gord, and he died in office. Now, let me tell you when I found out and how I found out there was money in politics. My family was well known in North Bay, the Vezina family. My uncle was the editor of the newspaper, my other uncle's the fire chief, and blah, blah, blah. So Merle knew all my family. Near Birchhaven, where we lived, there was a little corner store, Max Milk store. And I'm there one day, and in comes Merle with the campaign crews, and they're out knocking doors. And he recognizes me. He knows my dad. Hey, Vezina, get over here. So he says, what are you doing over here? Shouldn't you be in school? I said, I hang out here at recess and see if I can get someone to buy me a pop and a bag of chips. And he looks at me, and he says, here's $20. It's 12 cents for a pop, or 13 cents for a pop, and 12 cents for a bag of chips, right? Right, okay. So this will get you, like, you know, whatever it was, you know, 40 of them, whatever it is. He said, so every kid that comes over at recess, you buy them a pop and a bag of chips and tell them to tell their parents that Merle Dickerson bought it for them. So I went through that $20 at one recess. The next morning, instead of going to school, I went down to the mayor's office to get myself a job buying pops and bags of chips. And there's how I found out that there's money in politics. And at the end, when Merle Dickerson got thrown out for corrupt practices, because I'd worked for him in campaigns, I went to work for Honest Doc Jack Smiley, our local vet. He was Honest Doc Jack. And Honest Doc Jack had come everything but first in running for council. And in every election he'd run in, with no campaign, no nothing, put his name on the ballot, he either came second, third, or fourth. So I said, Jack, if you let me run a real campaign for you, and we put up campaign signs, and we actually pretend we want to win, you'll top the polls this time, and we'll make you mayor next time. We'll get rid of Merle. And he topped the polls, and in the next election, Jack Smiley became mayor because Merle was gone. And this was during in between he was gone for corrupt practices. So I saw politics from both sides. I saw politics as from a child, as business, money, and manipulation, and say whatever you have to say in order to get people to vote for you. And on the other hand, I was connected with one of the most honest, decent human beings you'd ever met in your entire life, who showed me that politics was about principles, is about doing what's important. And as you know, the reason I wasn't a conservative cabinet minister in the Mike Harris government is because I chose to listen to Doc Jack Smiley.
Greg Vezina is my guest. Thanks for that story. It really sets the backdrop about, you know, who you are and where you came from. Man, we've done a lot of stuff, eh?
Buddy, 93, we get a phone call. Mulroney, the NDP, the Liberals, and Conservatives on a Halloween, I think, Friday, passed a new bill that took all the assets of a party away if it didn't run 50 candidates. You needed 15% of the vote to get a subsidy. And so on and so forth. So, and I was fortunate enough. Yeah, right. I was treasurer. No, I was chief agent. The treasurer resigned. So now I was chief agent and treasurer of the party, the Green Party, as it disappears off the map. Right. So I got out the Rolodex and I started making the phone call, the same phone call I made to you. Hi, I need a favor. Sure, Vez. You're going to run for the Green Party. Are you out of your fucking mind? And you weren't the first person that said it to me. But we
probably
managed,
one of the last,
oh,
actually. I was down
God,
that
there
list.
There's a lot of people that have never spoken to me since that campaign. But the problem was they also made a rule that you had to have a $1,000 deposit and you only got $500 of it back if you got 15% of the vote. Wow. So as it is today, the rules were all rigged to favor the major parties and to crucify the little guys. And so we not only had to find 50 candidates, we had to come up with 50 grand. And Green Party candidates and supporters, as you know, don't generally drive Bentleys, right? They drive Diefenbuggies. So in any event, so we did. We borrowed 50 grand, basically. My wife lent a lot more of it than she thought we were going to, but we did it. And we got our 50 candidates, and we ran, and we got half our deposits back. And the Communist Party went to court and had all of those rules ruled unconstitutional, every one of them. So let's talk about today for a minute. We've got Ontario with Kathleen Wynne promising to do politics differently, which she has. She never said she'd do it worse than anyone's ever done it before. But when you're at 14% in the favorability level, listen, there's a story about in the American South that used to run what they call a yellow dog Democrat. It's meant you could run a yellow dog as a Democrat and it would win. In fact, they actually ran dead guys and they won. But I can tell you that Kathleen Wynne is so low on the polls that if she doesn't leave, if she stays and runs again, I predict the Liberal Party will not get the dozen seats it needs for official party status. And Ontario will do the opposite of what we did federally. Ontario will move to essentially a two-party right and left system. That's what I believe will happen. Now, prediction. If she leaves and they bring in someone from the outside who fires half the cabinet and sweeps the floor clean, they'll win a majority.
Wow.
There it
or
is.
Or that easy as an
that
electorate.
Easy. And so our politics has reached the point where we've gone from being a representative democracy with people representing us. My MP mattered. I know who my MP was. I could call them up. To party politics where the leader's office controls the game. And to where now the leader's office doesn't even control the game. The party controls the game. And the leader doesn't in many ways have a say, except if you're in power. So what happened?
Greg Vezina is my guest. He's the founder and chairman of a company called Hydrofuel Inc. None of the above party founder and leader. We're going to take a quick break, 2 minutes, and just going to use the bathroom, and then we'll come right back with more with you.
All right.
Then Mike Schreiner and Gord Miller and yourself are going to come up here and talk a little. We're just going to bullshit each other. Like we're sitting in the garage having some beers. So
Can I? No, Terry, can you drink when you talk?
Yeah, absolutely. Get a drink, man.
Hey.
Set this. We got Taps Brewery, local beer right on tap here. Taps Brewery, thank you very much. Thanks to Wellington Court. Quick break. Chris Curry's producing today. Thank you very much. We'll be right back.
Claims 1 million young lives every year. But for the first time in history, game-changing solutions are within our reach. Did you know that just $45 provides a full course of life-saving treatment to a malnourished child? Help save a child's life today. To donate to Action Against Hunger, please call 877-777-1420 or go to www.actionagainsthunger.org/donate.
Don't have the time to waste. Don't need to read my mind.
been holding on too tight. I never thought I'd be thinking I won. I've spent the whole summer sleeping. You've been staying up all night. I never thought I'd be thinking I won you. On the weekend, I've been holding on too tight. I never thought I'd be thinking I want. I spent the whole summer sleeping. You've been staying up all night. I never thought I'd be thinking I want. I've been so tired on the weekend. I've been holding on too tight. I never thought I'd be thinking I.
No, you know what? I better take a glass.
Yeah, I'll get some water.
Yeah, I don't want to promote Budweiser.
You told me I didn't have a poster, though. You might have to put this on there.
Yeah, yeah.
Is this this insane IPA, is that a local? I've never heard of it.
Are we live? We're going now?
Yeah, we are. We're on.
All right.
We're on with our insane IPA.
Testing, 1, 2, 3. We're just getting our shit together here at Sessions on the River. I'm Jim Fanning.
It's good beer.
That's Chris Curry, he owns the place. He's taking care of us. Mike Schreiner, leader of the GPO. Vez needs no introduction. We did talk about, we'll get back to none of the above. Gord Miller, former environmental commissioner, friends
shout
of mine.
Shout out to the house.
Yep.
This is really cool, eh?
Yeah.
This is a beautiful facility. It really is.
What an investment they put in here. And you can tell by looking around the place, right? I mean, everything's first class.
People should come down here tonight.
Yes.
They really should. Come on down. Absolutely.
It is really, really nice.
Local beer on tap, Taps Beer. Thanks to Wellington Court Restaurant, Dale and Eric Peacock. Awesome people. Thank you for doing it. Thanks to all the... we got a stack slate. It's on the web. Let's go to the Facebook page. We got some great talent coming up. Just before we start, Vez, touch on none of the above, Pirate. Come on,
for real. The whole idea that none of the above is, as I was saying, we've moved away from party politics and we've moved away from representative democracy, right? So... I'm saying what we need is the three R's of direct democracy. We need referenda. People need the right to force a vote on an issue if their politicians won't do it. And we need recall. We need the ability to get rid of politicians because you can't even get rid of them at an election. Whereas with a recall race focused on a candidate in particular, you could. And finally, we need the third R of direct democracy, which is real legislative and electoral reform for true accountability. And we don't have accountability. When the Auditor General has to sue the government to get the spending estimates, there's just something wrong. Okay, so the idea about the none of the above was to give people that option. Now, I'm speaking to the Premier. I spoke to the Chief Electoral Officer. There's a possibility the province will put none of the above on the ballot for 2018. The None of the Above party will cease to exist, change the name to Direct Democracy or whatever, and we will have a true option. Now, I won't tell anybody that's listening that you have the right in Ontario to decline your ballot,
right,
which means you stand up in front of the whole room and say, I'm not voting for anybody. Except that's how we used to vote. 200 years ago, we used to stand up in the room and tell everybody how we're voting. And then as soon as we went outside, they were waiting for us in the parking lot with baseball bats. Mm. That's why we went to a secret ballot. The reason the major parties in Ontario passed decline your ballot, so that you would be ridiculed if you didn't vote for one of them. Okay? And yet, in the 2014 election, as soon as people found out that you actually had the right to decline your ballot or there was a none of the above, we got an average of 1.5% of the vote. So we need an option to say, I don't like any of these people. And it's not enough to say, okay, none of the above won, now the second place guy goes in. We need what they have in Nevada and other places around the world. If none of the above wins, which it doesn't happen often, but if it wins, there's a new election, and none of the candidates or the parties that were on the previous ballot are allowed. So my great dream is for some democracy to come to Canada. I was hoping that it was going to come federally. I'm still hoping.
Well, hang on here. The Green Party has, you should know, Vez, and Ontario Green Party has a none of the above option on nominations, right?
All of our ballots have always had a none of the above option, and none of the above has actually won a few Green Party nominations.
And that means that somebody stands up, so I want to be the nominated candidate. You know, they're lined up behind Fannin because they're such a, you know, so many people want to be.
Why wouldn't you?
But, you know, people can say no.
Well, Javier.
You know, we don't like any of those people.
That's right.
And just find us somebody else, right? Look at the Americans now.
Yeah. They probably wish they could vote for none of the above.
Don't you think they wanted on the option none of the above?
Absolutely.
None of the above won both the Nevada Democratic and Republican gubernatorial races in one and another election.
Really?
It's actually one big.
And what did they
tickets.
Do?
Well, they pointed to second place there. They don't have a new one. But listen to this. Poland implemented none of the above when there was a single party government. And every candidate was defeated. They didn't even elect one. And Russia used to have an option of none of the above, but the same thing started happening. So they killed it. So just so you know, the UN Convention on Human Rights and Political Rights says you have the right, international law, to a secret ballot, and you have the right under international law to vote for none of the above, and that was used in India. They went to their Supreme Court, and it was ordered on the ballot in India. So the answer is, if the federal and Ontario governments do not implement this for the next federal and Ontario election, as soon as we see their bill, their new law, we're going to go to court, and we're going to ask the court to put it on the ballot.
Is that the only recourse we have, is to use the courts against the political parties?
Because pretty much.
And I'm going to throw this open to discussion. Yeah. You've been hoping and dreaming. You wrote a book on democracy 35 years ago. Yeah. Here we are again. We're still talking about the same things. It's rigged. I hate to use that, you know, as kind of a hot term these days. Municipal politics is rife with money and influence. We see it at the federal and provincial levels.
It's not as corrupt, though, municipally, in a sense. Okay?
It's a different kind of corruption.
I'll talk to a lot of municipal councilors and developers. But it's not trans-global corporations.
No.
Okay? You know, you get sold out locally, but you don't get sold out where we do federally. And it's interesting. You know, the scariest thing politically in terms of philosophy, because I'm a political scientist, right? So the scariest thing to me in the world is Donald Trump. And the most exciting thing in the world to me is Donald Trump.
No.
Right? Because And they're in for a big surprise on Election Day, I can tell you right now.
Yeah,
they're in for a very, very big surprise because people are not showing up for Hillary's rallies. People don't go vote to elect a shiny pony very often. And Hillary is no shiny pony. Okay? So, you know, and she's got big, big percentage of the vote amongst youth, but they won't have the turnout of the youth vote that we had in Canada. Okay? They won't. Point. In fact, this is something that happened in the last election, the first time in Canadian history. Young people were more involved in asking questions about politics during that campaign than senior citizens. They had the highest level of involvement in that federal election amongst young people ever.
Greg, so the one thing I want to say is I want to get back to Canadian politics, but while we're on the U.S.,
yeah.
I think the one difference, though, will be that Hillary actually has a machinery to get out the vote. And Trump doesn't have that.
That's what the Brexit said.
That is going to be, you know, I think in this case it's going to be an important distinction. And the other distinction is in the U.S. it's not by popular vote, it's by electoral college.
Right.
And yes. The electoral college favors the Democratic Party.
Yes.
And so she has a built-in advantage. So I think you may. I think Trump's numbers are going to be higher than the polls are predicting.
Right.
But I still think where. Hillary's going to win.
Well, it looks like Hillary's going to win. But I'm saying. The reality is, in protest elections, wrote a book on this, in protest elections, people do not show up and vote for the status quo.
That's
they
true.
They show
that's
up right. to throw out the status yeah. quo. Mm-hmm. And there is no lineup of there's no riots to get to the front line to vote for Hillary. Okay. There
well,
just isn't.
If the Republicans the had is, a semi-competent candidate, they would win.
Oh, it would be over.
Yes, yeah. right. But the other thing is that there's an awful lot of silent support for Trump. And people are just going to are mad. And the situation, the economic situation especially, the political situation in the United States, they're going to vote Trump, but they're not saying it because if you come out and say I'm a Trump supporter, you get attacked or ridiculed well, or whatever,
true.
Right?
Yeah.
Or keep your mouth shut and go
put
about.
Trump sides.
Like, I'm not promoting Trump here. I think it's, I'm none of the above in the States. But,
yeah. but Gordon and I are from the same school. See, we have an advantage over all you people because we're from North Bay.
That's
and
right.
in North Bay, nobody ever voted for Merle Dickerson.
I thought you were going to say it's because you're old.
Nobody voted for Merle Dickerson. He won 21 elections and he never won a poll. No public opinion poll ever showed Merle Dickerson was going to win.
No, but he
not
always won.
What? And he won. So, anyway.
One more Merle Dickerson story. I have a good friend who he got his driver's license when he was 16 and his dad said, "Here, take the car, go down to Merle's."
Campaign.
So he goes to that campaign. And so they put a guy in his car, one guy. And his job is, 16, he thinks it's a big thing, he's an election campaign, is to drive around a different poll, and that guy went and voted in every poll.
Right, exactly. So, vote early, vote often. Yeah.
So, wow. Anyway. That's politics.
But
oh, well.
That was years ago. It's not like that today.
Gord Miller, Greg Vezina, Mike Schreiner, really great having you guys here. We've kind of skirted a bunch of the issues today. We didn't even get into hydrofuel. Let's talk a little bit about alternative energy. What's gone wrong with the green plan? Samsung mates off with how, and I am of the belief that every issue, healthcare, electoral reform, foreign affairs, electoral reform, taxes, electoral reform, everything to me is based on the fact that we give these fucking guys majority governments right. to bend us over without our consent on free trade, on GST, on whatever the hell they want, money, taking care of their friends, Samsung, it's been that way a long time. And until that every issue that drives you crazy, if someone knew it was connected to the way we elect these turkeys and the way that you're majority represented by a minority of the support, we are electing governments with
37% popular
vote. But we
have a way out. Vote green every time. We're given the option.
And that hasn't been working so well for us either. Here, Mike's been doing a good job on the outside. But to me, it's all about...
This guy here has forgotten more about the environment than most people alive. And the one thing that he did was he issued his reports. Okay, and his reports had the numbers.
Yeah,
okay.
They did.
Based now, we've had two auditor generals that said that our Liberal government implemented their green plan with absolutely having no zero, not a number at all. Right. And then our company with the University of Ontario Institute of Technology just released a major research paper on the life cycle analysis of green energy, of brown energy, and of ammonia energy. Now, the most exciting part of all this is it turns out when you take hydrocarbons and convert them into ammonia and urea, you capture the carbon and it makes us mining all our hydrocarbons viable and usable. When you take renewable energy and instead of selling it to the Americans or paying them $2 billion a year to take our excess green power, you turn it into ammonia and then make peak power, it works. So the interesting thing about the report was, is that, by the way, ammonia works. So anybody in TV land, look up ammonia fuel. But the other part of the report was it showed the big mistake the Ontario government did. They didn't do a life cycle analysis. And when you close coal plants and partially replace them with natural gas plants, nobody did an emissions analysis. They claim that's green. But there's a lot more to emissions than CO2. There are seven different categories of emissions. Methane emissions from natural gas are far worse for us over a short period of time, over the next 20, 50, 100 years, than CO2. Will we discover technologies to help over the next 100, 200, 500 years to deal with CO2? Maybe.
Will we
but
have?
We can't.
Do we have 100 years left?
But do we don't. And ozone, ozone emissions are instantaneous. They're now. Yeah. The impact is now. You stop the ozone, you stop the problem a day later. But we've increased the ozone emissions here 10 times in the last 5 years alone with methane emissions, et cetera, et cetera. Mm. So the one thing we've never done is we've never done a true life cycle analysis. And the second thing we've never done is use the tax system to put the cost of pollution in the price of what we pay. And if we did yep. that alone, stop subsidizing brown energy, stop subsidizing green energy, put the price of pollution in the price, that's where green energy wins. That's where it's cheaper.
Right. So I just want to correct you on one thing, because you're usually right on these things, Vez.
Hey, I make mistakes.
There was one person who pointed out the numbers on natural gas having the emissions go up. No, it's this guy right here.
Yeah.
Environment came from Ontario. And then he pointed it out. Yeah. And then afterwards, there would be a scrum out in the halls of Queen's Park with the media. And he would usually say something like what you just said, that you got to put a price on pollution. And the other three parties with seats at Queen's Park, when the media would come and ask them about that, they would all go running. None of them would want to talk about it. And there was one guy, one lonely little guy without a seat at Queen's Park, who would sit in the hallway and say,
right.
we have to put a price on pollution.
Yeah.
If we're going to solve this problem, we have to put a price on pollution. And the other mistake the Liberals made, which you hinted at, was they picked winners and losers.
Right.
And governments usually are never very good
they
at picking the winners
pick
and losers.
The right ones.
And the biggest problem the Liberals made is they put corporate interests ahead of community interests. And if you look at the best way that green energy has been rolled out in other countries, Denmark and Germany in particular, it's been community power. Communities, local people own it. Yeah. It isn't corporate power.
Let me tell you a quick story about that, because I was part of as commissioner. I went overseas early 2000s. You know, I forgot exactly what year. I went to the Netherlands, right? We were looking at some waste technology. And we looked at their wind turbines, and we didn't have any here, right, that time, right? And we were talking about it, right? And the Dutch said, whatever you do, don't do it with private corporations.
Right.
Do it as community power, because
they
had made all the mistakes, and they knew the right way to do it, right?
Wow.
And they told us. That's the one thing you got to get right. Do it as community power. Of course, what did we do?
Wow.
Not that.
There's an even... You're absolutely right.
People really don't know the deal that Samsung got.
There's an even...
No, they don't.
But it's not just the
Samsung deal.
The
guy, the first person who criticized that deal was actually the leader of the Green Party of Ontario. And it freaked out a lot of environmentalists. They're like, why are you criticizing this? And I'm like, it is wrong to do backroom deals, whether it's with fossil fuel companies or with green energy companies.
Yeah.
Backroom deals are wrong, period.
But what's even worse is this, is fundamental science. And this man will tell you. There are two ways to utilize wind energy. One is to create four times as much as the wind energy if you're going to put it on a province-wide grid like Ontario, because your province-wide transmission losses are half. That's just what it takes in a province this big, okay? And
don't tell a nuclear guy. Sir.
And for every kilowatt of power that you create for wind, you have to create a kilowatt for backup. So for every
kilowatt hour you create for nuclear, you have to have a backup too.
We know that too.
Exactly.
We know that too. But let me finish my story.
Okay.
All right. So, but what they didn't do was they didn't look at the full picture. Okay. Mm. And I'll give you a couple examples. In Great Britain, they subsidized over 1 million wind farms, but they did not connect them to the grid because they realized it was going to cost them four times as much. So you know what they did? They subsidized backing them up with diesel power. Now, in Northern Ontario, the government just announced they're building a 1,500-kilometer hydro line from Thunder Bay, where there's no generating capacity for peak time. They're going to give them off-peak interruptible power for 12,000 First Nations in Northern Ontario. And it's going to replace their diesel generators, which for 40 years under this contract are going to be backed up by diesel. Okay? The University of Ontario did a study saying that we could do it on ammonia for a quarter of the cost if we ship the ammonia in for 40 years. But if within 10 years you could use wind power up there to make enough ammonia to not only fuel the generators but also provide the fuel that industry and everybody else uses, we could do it at a tenth of the cost. Mm-hmm. Ontario, if you go to their website and look at their definition of fuels in Ontario, ammonia is not classified as a fuel in Ontario.
No, that's right.
In 1863, it was classified as a fuel in the United States and Europe.
Well, and remember, remember, Vez, when we were... I forgot which, you know, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the big science thing, for worldwide science thing, it reports every 5 years on climate change. Yeah, exactly. So one day I was sitting in my office, and the I forgot which version, I'm too many years.
Number four.
Yeah, number four comes out, right, comes the big report, and of course, you know, I got to go through this thing, you know, it's massive amount of science. Going through, hit a page, got to call Vez. Says right there, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, what is one of their promising things? Ammonia. Right there, right?
And I said, ammonia.
You know, you can imagine, right? Yeah. You know Vez, right?
So, 27,000
the commissioner picks up the phone and says, get the IPCC report, turn to page 462.
And, you know, so the interesting thing is, in that case, they found that first, the ammonia plants, a lot of the ammonia plants we have aren't efficient. So if you increase the efficiency of the plants, you use what they call a CRES technology, you reduce renewable energy, et cetera, et cetera. We could mitigate more CO2 doing that than any carbon sequestration technology that existed. So
that is true, but it's not saying a lot because the carbon sequestration technologies that they're promoting are so bad.
Yeah, exactly. But so anyway, so the bottom line is that, you know, I'm a little out there, as you know, and I come up with some policies that are a little extreme. And about 35 or 40 years later, someone says you were right all along.
Can we
take this back to one thing I mentioned earlier, though? Sure. Is look at who donates to political parties.
Oh, of course.
And so the nuclear industry is one of the most powerful lobbies in this province. And if you also even look, and I know it drives me crazy sometimes when the Conservatives do this, but they have a point, is if you look at the wind companies that donated to the Liberal government and which ones got contracts and which ones didn't donate to the government, didn't get contracts.
Well, or
and so Vez,
or I, got their offshore things canceled.
Canceled because they didn't donate, exactly.
Which were the best ones of all.
Which would have been the best ones, exactly. The most financially responsible ones are the ones they cut. So anyway, Vez, your problem is you don't vote, you don't donate enough money to the Liberal government.
You're absolutely right.
Okay, we just solved the problem.
I should have asked
the Liberals if they would dig Merle Dickerson up out of the grave and run him as leader, and then we could have had a dead dinosaur who probably would have governed Ontario better than this present government.
Oh, whatever.
On that note, let's wrap this shit up. Let's get you guys off stage. Thank you so much for coming out. Grab a beer. Mike Schreiner, leader of the Green Party of Ontario, I really appreciate your time. I know you're busy. I love your work. I see what you're doing. You're making press releases all the time on topical things. You're in play. I really love that about you. Vez, good friend of mine for so long. Thank you for being there for so many years. And, you know, maybe we'll do this again. Gord, again, it doesn't happen without you guys saying yes, but Gordon, you know, for taking time and saying, I appreciate the
and driving 1,000 kilometers.
Appreciate the 1,000 kilometers and the time. And I told you I'll put you up at Ontario's finest hotel tonight.
Well, at least you got good local food, local music, local beer.
That's right.
All of that here.
Thank you very much. And speaking of local, coming up next we got Lupish and Crew. So Chris Curry is running the board over there. He's the owner operator of Sessions on the River. He's going to get us out. Short break, and then we're coming back with Lupish, Sherwood, On Point Creative, the film Fight. I'm Jim Fannin. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Thank you. Right.
Cheers.
You're like silver and gold, but I can't hold it, baby. This is getting old. You're like silver and gold, but I can't hold it, baby. This is getting old. You're running through my veins, every thought, every word.
Make me feel alive in spite of rising walls. Days go by, still no sign of your ghost. Never call, never write, it's a loss. It make me feel alive in spite of rising water. Abandoning my car about a mile from nowhere. It's made me feel alive in spite of rising water. Abandoning my car about a mile from nowhere. You make me feel alive in spite of rising water. Abandoning my car about a mile from nowhere. It's made me feel alive in spite of rising water. Abandoning my car about a mile from nowhere. A mile from nowhere. A mile from nowhere. A mile from nowhere.
Let's get the start and tear apart like we were never lost. You'll tumble in my grave, but you won't find the answers. We're together lost, we're forever lost. You're 20 seconds late, I'm 20 seconds gone. I'm holding on for hours, and we're forever torn between the lights and the under.
Thank you.
Test 1, 2, 3. This is James Melville Fannin. We are coming to you live from Sessions in the River on the beautiful shores of the great Niagara River in Fort Erie, Ontario, at the base of the Peace Bridge. I am Jim Fannin, pimping all that is good and musical today in Niagara. We love everyone that came in. Thanks to the last panel, the green panel. And now we're... so thrilled to have you guys here. This is cast and crew of the film Fight. It's a Lupus Sherwood production. Jay's on the keys. Or yeah. The baby grand or the grand piano is our set today. Just grateful to have you guys. I know. So Erica Sherwood, we're going to talk about you right now. But Sarah Murphy Dyson's coming up at 7 o'clock. Anthony Sweet is next. Like Sarah Murphy Dyson, your movie kind of shifted my life. It kind of impacted me. It made me think, and I fell in love with your character. She's the coolest thing on the planet, right? So thank you, Jason. And so all I see then is you and Beth Moore and Brad Moore, and the synergy was amazing, and the scenery was my own hometown of St. Catharines. And then the music score was great, and you rescored it, and then brought the local guys in, and that was awesome. Like Faceless and Weightless and Faceless is that Aaron Berger song, and then Anthony Botting at the end with Echoes, and he played that today.
God. It was great. We got to see them today, which is
check that out. So yeah, Botting is just magical, and Anthony Sweet, who I described that way, is coming up next. So I want to give you guys some time. Number one, thank you, Jason and Erica, for a kind of wonderful thing.
You are our biggest fan, and we love it.
Well, I don't know about that, but you guys did a really nice job on the premiere. It was red carpet at Brock. It wasn't the same old people that I see, you know, when I used to go to those events. And I thought it spoke to a lot of class. And, you know, I didn't know what to expect. I was expecting, Jason, no offense, to see the Beachcombers type of shots. And the bad acting and the weak scripts, and it just all looks so Canadiana, and I really expected to see that, and what I got was fucking Hollywood in St. Catharines. I'm really proud of you guys. So thank you for that gift. And I know it's getting picked up and getting distributed. I bought it. I watched it alone on Valentine's Day. Is that when it came out? Oh, yeah. I watched Letterkenny the full season, and then I, you know, had to... Yeah, take a couple Valiums. I'm like, no. Anyway, so that's re-seeing it again.
Oddly enough, Letterkenny is produced by another kid from St. Catharines, Mark Montefiore.
Wow, I didn't know that, and what a genius program. Nothing original like that's come out of anywhere since Trailer Park Boys. I'm having a lot of fun with it. So the new film, Fight. tell us about the people sitting around the table here. And where's the motivation? Because is this the one that's going to make us big money here as, community investors? Have you raised some sponsorship yet? Just tell us all about Fight.
Well, we're working on it. We're here today with, obviously, Erica Sherwood, who stars and produces the film with me, and then Gabriella McAlpine, who is also starring in the film, and Tino Notarieni, who is also starring in the film. And there's a bunch of people who wish they could have been here, but they're busy working, doing plays and such. So, no, it's great. It's taken us quite a while to get to this point. Fight is an idea that I've been working on for 6 years, probably. I think I came up with the idea while we were shooting A Kind of Wonderful Thing, and just working on the script for quite a while.
Cool.
And then decided to abandon the script completely.
Cool. And it's film noir. Is that what you like? I see this hashtag. Is that the hashtag? Is black and white, isn't it?
It's black and white, but it's not film noir.
Okay. Okay. I don't know the difference. I think I saw it.
It's a dramatic action film. It's along the lines of
Raging Bull.
like a Nicholas Winding Refn film. Sort of along those lines. Maybe not as dark as his films. Like Drive, it's a slow sort of build
tension
to the
build,
climax.
Yeah.
A lot of tension, a lot of character development, and then a lot of people snapping at the end.
Cool. And you mentioned you threw the script out.
We did.
So, for real, like this is a movie that's going without a script.
Yeah. Well, we have a basic outline.
Right.
so loopish.
And it's changing even as we go, as we
wow.
shoot. And
cool.
Yeah, it's this new sort of thing that we're trying. I feel like we've done movies in the past where it's like, here's the script, and you know, because the whole process of making a movie is you write a script and then you shoot it and then you edit it, and through those stages you sort of come up with a different film every time. So whatever you write is one thing, and then you shoot something different, and then you edit something a little bit different after that. And I feel like that's true for most films, but with this I really wanted to experiment more with the process of being more creative and not artistic, I guess, because we're trying to make a commercial film. Like, we're trying to make something that a wide audience is going to enjoy. That's why we made it about fighting, because I think people want to see action in films and stuff like that. But I also think that they connect with characters and people on a real level. So, but yeah, the idea was to, yeah, just kind of wing it. And not really wing it. We sort of know where we're going with it.
Right.
But I like the idea that things can change and evolve and develop organically as we go. And so, yeah, we're just trying something different. I just got bored with making movies the way that people make movies. It's kind of like, I guess with music as well. It's like you go into a studio and you make a song the typical way that you would. And we did this thing back in the spring with Tony Decker from the Great Lakes Swimmers. We did a little documentary about him coming home to Port Colborne for the first time in years. And just the process that he took when making his first album, where they went out to this silo in Waynefleet and just smashed some rocks together to make sounds. And I'm like, that's kind of the approach that I want to take with making movies. It's just like, let's just go out with a camera and people and an idea and then put that together to make something.
Now, Erica, what can you tell us without giving, I don't know if you can tell us anything about the character that you're developing and your personal investment in it? I mean, we joked, and I get to get behind the scenes with you guys, and we'll talk about that later. I got a song coming out, actually, that'll be performing later. I don't know if you knew that, but I also say I have a movie coming out, so dealing with my scene on the floor. what personal, and I know that you made a personal investment with a kind of wonderful thing, you know, that whole drama of the sickness, the terminal illness, and wow, what kind of investment are you making in this character?
Well, this is like the complete opposite of what I envisioned for myself in real life, which is to have a kid and to just be a single mother, and feeling the pressure in that.
Wow.
How will I ever feel what that actually is like without research and stuff like that? So. I couldn't really research that kind of thing, because I think it's too hard unless you're actually in it. And I think so the only real experience I've had was just hanging out with Jason's kids and kind of feeling what it's like to be that kind of parent that's either divorced or separated from their the mother or the father. So that's the only experience that I've had. So I kind of had to dig in my life for loss and things that I would fight for that could, you know, relate to that kind of pressure, which is very, very hard for me because I never wanted a kid. So to get there was very, very hard for me. But everybody has experienced pressure and loss and something that they absolutely need to keep in their life, and what would they do to keep that in their life. So for my character Alex, who's basically this single mother who loses their job and needs to make ends meet for their daughter, what would she do? How far would she go? So my character goes further than I think any other mother would do, which was to risk her own life for her own kid, which is to go into underground bare-knuckle boxing for easy money, fast money. Right. Not easy money, I shouldn't say that. fast money, because she's experienced that before she was pregnant, where she was able to make money as an underground bare-knuckle boxer. So she decides to go back into that world that was very risky and risks her own life for her own kid to make ends meet.
So how about, is it impacting you? Like, we joked, like, stay in character! Like, do you drag it home with you? Do you carry the baggage with you when you come home, or can you turn it off?
I can turn it off only because I have never wanted a kid. Wow. So it's easy for me to take it off. But at the same time, to get to that place where it's heart and soul and caring so much about a human being, like, we've all done that before. We've cared about a human being that much before. Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of, well, who have you cared for? You know, my father, my mother, whatever it is. How far would you go for the person that you love is basically the baggage.
Erica Sherwood's my guest, Jason Lupish. They are On Point Creative. Gabby, thank you for coming. I really appreciate your time. Thanks for being patient, waiting through all these political guests. What's your contribution to the movie? You having fun with this thing or what? Is this what you've always wanted to do? First film?
It's my first film. I've always wanted to be in a movie or do acting.
And what are you playing?
I'm playing the character Sam.
Okay. And which is in relation to Erica?
No. Well,
no?
No relation whatsoever.
Okay. Maybe we can
continue.
Too much of the plot away? I don't know. What kind of experiences, you know, being on set all the time is, you know, we all think it's glamorous, the people that don't do it, that you try and lay this stuff down. It's hard work, huh?
Yeah. It's a lot of time consuming too. Like, I've always wanted to be on a movie set, but I didn't think it'd be hard, like, what it really was. And, like, I'd go there, and I'd be there for long hours. And I'd always, like, want to go out with friends, but then I'd have to stay to, like,
sacrifice.
Do the movie. So then I'd be doing the movie, and then next day I'd be doing, like, filming again and over. And I didn't think you'd have to do the scene so many times.
I get my lupus jab in. Usually I gotta let that one fly. I'm turning over a new leaf. It's all good.
I thought you'd only have to do, like, film the scene like 4 times, but then, like,
yeah,
it's always like 20 times, but then, like, it changes. Like, Jason would always be like, no, be sad, no, this time be angry, this time. He'd always switch it up and see what works better.
Yeah, well, that's awesome. And I know it's the same in music, man. These guys get in studio and it's over and over and over and over. And I just sat through one session one day here. I'm like, oh, geez, oh, I hear that song one more time. Tino, how are you enjoying the set, man? How'd you get recruited by these dudes? Does someone know someone a favor here? Or, like, what's...
So it would appear that way, but I believe it was Erica had messaged me and said, you mind coming out for a screen test? We're working on a new feature. And I said, yeah, sure, I'd love to. Unknowing what it was, plot, premise, anything like that, she said, wear something surfery. I was like, okay, fair enough. So I show up, and basically my role for the day was to share a slow dance in a bar while slightly intoxicated. So
with who?
With Erica.
Oh, come on, I didn't get
not
that
Jay,
call.
Not Jay.
Come on, man.
So as flattering as it would have been to share a dance with Jay, but it was with Erica. So
interesting, too.
Yes, getting into character, had a few cocktails, decided wouldn't do it much justice if I was completely sober, so went for it. But anyway, then they pitched the idea that it was a movie about underground fighting. My character would be not the voice of reason, but he's definitely more... He's relatable, likable, to an extent, of course. Okay. For most people who watch it, once the movie comes out, I hope it's enjoyed and well received. But he's not really such a terrific guy all the way through. I mean, nobody is so.
Right.
But I play Erica's love interest, or vice versa, and
you bastard.
Yeah, more or less. My characters, Justin, he's a single father, has a little boy, Mikey. He's played by a very talented young actor. So most of the scenes I've had, I haven't had any scenes with Gabby, but I have with Erica. Her daughter, Sam, is played, obviously. What's her?
Eve.
Eve, yeah. Yes. One great children actors. It's incredible. So I've had a lot of fun with that. But that's basically the the synopsis of my character. Awesome. Who is. But of course, with as Jay said earlier, there's going to be some evolutions within the script. So
absolutely,
that may change. But up until this point,
yes. And Tino's been on a few of our films.
Cool.
He was in. We were trying to figure this on the way here. What was the first thing that we worked on? Was it the Bayview Flowers commercial that we shot probably four years ago that just got released now? And then we did One Last Christmas, which was a short film. that we released a couple of Christmases ago that we'll probably release again this year. Where Tino got to make out with Jeff Malish.
Jeffrey.
Okay, Jeffrey. So just on the way out, I want to touch on this. And sorry, guys. I know you waited around a long time, but I want to stay on schedule because Anthony Sweet's coming up at 6. Talk to me about the script for Jeff Malish. You know,
For Fight?
You didn't make him gay in this, did you?
Well, no.
No. You can't give anything away? Well, he just happens to kiss a man? What do you mean, kiss the man?
The original idea was that Gabby's character was going to run away from home. So she is she's growing up. Her father raised her. No, originally it was her mother raised her, and then her mother ends up dying, and she has nobody, so she has to leave home and try and find her estranged father. We then flipped that around and made it, she's going looking for her mother. So Jeff was supposed to play her father. So I'm like, Jeff, like this was back in June, like grow a beard. And just,
which is killing him,
yeah,
by the
grow
way.
Beard.
It's like, I can't wait to shave this off. They won't let me. They got a couple.
And so he did that, and we did some screen tests with him and another actress who was originally going to play the role that Gabby plays. And he grew this beard and everything, and he just looks fantastic. But then we cut the father role. And I'm like, Jeff, don't worry. I'm like, we'll find something else for you.
Okay. Not again. You cut me again.
Yeah, we found that, but we got this great role for him as Charlie, who is Erica's or Alex's fight promoter.
Like you've never seen him before, I think.
Like seen him before. He pulls out an incredible performance. But I mean, everyone does.
And your film's
so
a classic
like
for that.
Like you watch the trailer. Everyone's just.
Everyone wants to be a supporting actor, and he's a supporting actor now.
Yeah, it's really on a whole other level.
Yeah.
I mean, right across the board, everyone has put in so much effort, and it's just incredible.
Cool, man. I really appreciate the time.
We only have like half the film in the can right now, so.
Yep.
All right, well, we'll look for ways that we can support you in the community and financially. I know you're selling some sponsorship for it. Thanks for waiting around today and coming in.
Absolutely.
It was important for me to get you guys in. Hey, Chris, we're going to locate that trailer before you go. Lupus has got a trailer for the movie Fight. We'll get them to load that up. But Anthony Sweet, you better get down here and get your trombone out and get all your everything set up for your little set at 6 o'clock because we're staying on time. I'm Jim Fannin. Thanks again to the cast and crew and some of the producers, actors, and promoters. God, you guys play all the roles here from the movie Fight Film.
Fight.
Check it on Facebook, Instagram, Jason Lupus.
Yeah, Facebook.com/Fight Film.
I'm Jim Fannin, and we'll be right back with Anthony Sweet.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks for watching the Jim Fannin Show. Jim paid me $20 to say this. Tonight's show was produced by Chris Curry. This has been an Earth
Bring
Sky Water production, and you can be anywhere in the world, yet you chose to be with us. Good night.
And thank you for that. Paul Brady, all right.
Love it. Hey,